Legislative Report. I'm Laura Mano, joined today by Senator Leroy Comrie. Senator Comrie represents the 14th Senate District in Queens. Today we will discuss with Senator Comrie his first legislative session.
Thanks for joining us today, Senator.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate the opportunity.
Yes, glad to have you here.
So this is your first session in the Senate, but you have had a distinguished career in the New York City Council. What are your first impressions of the Senate and Albany in general?
Well, you know, it's a much different. I was honored to serve the community and the council for 12 years. I have a leadership position in the council. I was head of the Queens delegation and ended up chair of the Land Use Committee. I'm coming here as a freshman with no seniority and a different house with a different set of rules and different practices and policies to get things happen. A lot more formal environment. It's a beautiful chambers, and it has a lot of history and tradition to it. And I'm learning the traditions. I'm learning the history. I'm learning how the process works up here and how we make sure that the community has an opportunity to be impacted. The main difference, I think, between Albany and New York City is that the way committee hearings are held and how quickly the committee hearings are held, and that we don't have the opportunity for public input at our committee hearings. It's interesting that at committee hearings there's no real discussion other than between members, and you have to understand that if you don't raise your hand quickly, that the bill or the issue could fly right by because they the way that they handle the committee meetings, if you don't interject very quickly, the subject matter can be discussed and dismissed and ended. So it's a different environment, but it's one that I'm adapting to and learning and appreciating what it is. You know, to sit at a desk that has over 100 years of history in it, if you open up my desk, you'll see signatures going back to the early 1900s. It's, you know, pretty, it's a heady experience, but, you know, my community sent me up here for a clear reason, and that was to help them with the services and things that they need. So I'm, you know, trying to do my best to establish my presence here, to make members understand what I'm about, and to make everyone in state government understand that the residents of the 14th District need help.
Right. Now, you mentioned the committee hearings, and obviously one of the largest pieces of the legislative session is the state budget.
Right.
So the budget includes committee hearings like that as well. And I know you were concerned that the recently passed budget did not include enough funding for foreclosure relief. We do have a clip of you speaking about that on the Senate floor, so let's watch that, and then we'll talk a little bit about the issue.
Great. And I wanted to further echo what Senator Sanders and Senator Espiota and others said about the $5 billion surplus. As my district, adjoining Senator Sanders, was one of the hardest hit from the foreclosure, that $5 billion surplus that is not a surplus. It's the blood and sweat and tears of people that were robbed by the system, people that were hoodwinked by the system, and we in government should do our best to ensure that the majority of that surplus is given to programs that can prevent foreclosures, that could keep people in their homes, to provide opportunities for people to stay in their apartments, to create more affordable housing, and not to do anything else with that money. So I am a resounding no on this bill because it's leaking that money into it. And as I said earlier, the asthma rates in our communities, the same communities that are hit by high foreclosure rates, by neglect of government, are not being served in this bill. I vote no.
So can you explain a little bit about the foreclosure relief issue and what you were looking to get in the budget?
Well, you know, the Attorney General got over $5 billion in return funds that were gained from the working poor, people that got scammed, people that were hoodwinked by different levels, from the banks to real estate people to insurance people that ripped them off, and they wound up losing their homes or losing their abilities to stay in their homes. And this is money that was recouped to help them get their restoration so that they could get back into a proper living environment, and also to prevent other people from falling into foreclosure. But most of that $5 billion was taken and used for other programs, used for other things other than foreclosure relief. So I was quite disappointed and you know, flustered with the fact that many people in the state didn't seem to want to make that happen. and appreciated the need to ensure that we continue to help, because we have more people now than ever that are still facing problems with foreclosure, that are still having problems with maintaining their homes, that got into bad loans and bad deals and were given bad advice about their income so that they would not be able to sufficiently pay the taxes, to pay the utility bills, and they're consistently, because of the stagnation in income and opportunity in the state as well, you know, their income is not rising. A lot of people purchased homes based on future earnings that are not happening. Mm-hmm. So they wound up not being able to maintain these homes. And we have many properties in Southeast Queens that are consistently in foreclosure crisis. And no matter where I go, what meeting I attend, someone's coming up to me telling me they're having a foreclosure problem.
Now, the state budget is obviously a large topic, and many issues are discussed during that process.
Right.
Aside of foreclosure relief, would you say that you were satisfied with what happened in the budget, or were there things missing that you had been fighting for?
Oh, there were key elements missing that we needed. You know, the foreclosure money, the support for infrastructure in our area, the support for after-school program, the money for summer youth employment that got maintained at the same amount, other than a adjustment for the inflation, you know, but not one additional job was created. You know, I had the opportunity to be a summer youth employment worker, and that's a critical opportunity for young people. And we have many young people that are looking for work. They would like to be gainfully employed or given an opportunity to learn something. And the summer youth employment program is only going to be able to hire less than 30,000 kids in a city where you have over 300,000 children that are going to be actively trying to find work. It's just not, it's a problem that creates other issues. You create children that will be loitering, children that will be surfing the internet, children that will be looking for things to do and finding trouble because they don't have a gainful employment. I think it's going to wind up costing the state four times the amount of money in trying to fix the problems that these kids will do, to the graffiti that they're going to do, the petty larceny that they're going to do, to hit the negative things that they will do to themselves. If we gave them all jobs and gave them a career, do the summer youth employment program, it illuminates real opportunities for kids. You know, the NYCHA money, not making sure that NYCHA got the full funded, the dealing with the MTA capital plan. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of disappointment in the budget. But it's the first budget that I was able to work on and be involved in. And, you know, also the level of direct involvement in the budget as well is a lot different in the state than it is in the city. It's a lot less opportunities for us to be directly involved in the budget or to speak to issues. And I'm still learning the nuances of how to effectively get something in front of the people that count. To make something happen. As you know, one of our fights in the Democratic Senate was to get our leader in the room to be part of the negotiations. So, you know, this three men in the room ideal came as a governor's mandate. There's no state charter, there's no state rule that requires that it's just three persons in a room. It's just happened over time. There's no reason why we shouldn't have the leader of the Democratic State Senate conference to be in a room when we have, you know, the Democratic members of the state Senate have actually the highest amount of voters, combined, even though we don't have the majority of the members because the upstate counties are so rural. We actually have more residents that are in the Democratic conference, so we should be there. We have the downstate part of the state that's a critical to the economy of the entire state. You know, like it or not, the downstate generates more money than upstate. It helps to fund and ensure that the entire state budget is funded, and we don't have representatives that are sitting in the critical rooms to make decisions about how our dollars are going to be spent or how policy is being written. So, you know, we had a major effort to try to let the entire state know that this was incorrectly done and we needed to make sure that got changed. And we made some points. We impacted the governor, definitely, and hopefully, you know, whenever there's leadership meetings that are being held, he will make sure to conference with our conference, and especially our leader, you know, Senator Andrea Stewart-Cousins.
Now, obviously, you're very invested and dedicated to your district, and I do see you are wearing your orange tie today, and I was wondering if there was any significance to your community that that has, and what that's about.
Not just my community, but today is National Gun Violence Awareness Day. I have a program in my district, Life, the Life program, run by Erica Ford and the Cure Violence program, and they sent out an email reminding me that today was National Gun Violence Day and that we should wear orange ties or orange clothing to celebrate that and to note that and to remind people that we are trying to do everything we can as a community, as a city, as a nation, to try to reduce gun violence in our communities. The taking of a life, the using of a weapon to try to hurt someone is something that we need to do everything we can to figure out other modes, other means, and other opportunities to teach people how to, you know, deal with situations in a nonviolent manner.
We have time for one more quick question, and it's kind of connected to what you were just talking about with gun violence. This session, one of the largest topics that's being discussed and kind of thrown around is the need for criminal justice reforms and to discuss kind of police-community relations. What's your connection to that issue?
Well, I'm working with the Black and Hispanic Asian Caucus. I'm running from here to a meeting where we're talking about how to make sure that the gun violence and criminal justice reform package and dealing with police community relations are at least addressed in this budget before the end of this month. There are many things that need to be addressed, and we're going to do as much as we can to talk to the Republican majority in the Senate to get some of these things done. And fortunately, the Republicans in the state Senate want to increase penalties for crimes. You know, we want to make sure that there's other opportunities for young people to, you know, one of the things that as I said earlier, you know, you don't fund programs like the Summer Youth Employment Program or after school programs or workforce programs enough to keep people off the street, to keep people away from trouble. So they're going to resort to silly things and then wind up getting a record and wind up getting criminalized. And we want to do things necessary to ensure that within the criminal justice package that there are more programs and opportunities to help people from recidivism, that if they get involved in a problem, that they can work their way out of it, that they can create opportunities or a path to success, even if they had a minor crime in the beginning, and not get further driven into criminalization because they don't have any other options. So a big part of the criminal justice package is to ensure that, you know, we create opportunities for the legal system to show people another path.
Right. So I think that this is probably just enough time for you to kind of talk to your constituents, let them know what you're fighting for the rest of session, and what they can see and expect from you once session's over in your district.
Well, they'll see me back in the district on an everyday basis. I look forward to coming in and talking and working with my constituents. I hope to have my district office relocated back to Farmers Boulevard. But in the budget, we're going to be fighting for criminal justice reform. We're going to be fighting to work on the 421A bill. We're going to be fighting for rent control. We're going to be fighting to make sure that there are resources that are given to the 14th Senate District. We're going to be fighting to try to ensure that the state doesn't put a close-to-home program right in the next to a residential neighborhood. You know, we have a lot of fights to do in a short time. We're going to be trying to help people in this budget to make sure that the quality of their lives in the 14th Senate District are the best that they can be, and that the state is even more responsive to the residents of the 14th Senate District than they ever have been before. And that's my challenge. That's my fight. I'm looking forward to, you know, working with everyone in the state to make sure that they understand that the 14th Senate District, which, you know, is the best Senate district in the state, I believe, is well served.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. I really appreciate you taking the time to talk to your constituents.
Well, thank you. I appreciate your time, Laura.
Thank you. Thank you for watching the Legislative Report. For more information on Senator Comrie and all he is doing in your area, please visit comrie.nysenate.gov.